Hi, this is Corey Franklin with Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight, we're going to start out with Art Modell, who died recently at the age of 87. And I imagine if this podcast was only going to Cleveland, we wouldn't be able to show his picture because Art Modell is not well regarded in Cleveland. In fact, he may be the most disliked man there ever was in Cleveland. You can consider him the Walter O'Malley of Cleveland. He was the owner of the beloved Cleveland Browns from the early 1960s until 1995, when he packed up the team, lock, stock, and barrel, and moved them to Baltimore, and they became the Baltimore Ravens. This was the ultimate act of disloyalty to all Clevelanders. They never forgave him for this, and his name lives in infamy in the streets of Cleveland. Art Modell was a nice Jewish boy born in Brooklyn, just like another maverick NFL owner who we did recently, Al Davis. Art Modell went to New Utrecht High School. He dropped out of school. He puttered around New York City. He made a lot of money in advertising and in television. And in the early 1960s, he decided to go to Cleveland and buy the Cleveland Browns. He borrowed most of the money to do it. But the Cleveland Browns were a high-profile franchise in the early 1960s in the NFL. They were coached by Paul Brown, who had won a number of championships in the old All-America League. There are many people who say Paul Brown was the greatest professional football coach ever, and the Browns of the early 1960s were led by Jim Brown, who many consider the greatest running back of all time, might be the greatest running back I ever saw. Well, Art Modell had a love-hate relationship with the people of Cleveland, and the early hate was engendered primarily by his decision to fire Paul Brown. Art Modell was a hands-on owner. Paul Brown was a pretty controlling guy. Only one of them could stay, and it turned out that it was going to be Art Modell. So he fired Paul Brown, who was basically a legend and a hero in Ohio. Besides his championships in the old All-America Conference, he coached Massillon High School to a high school national championship, and he went to Ohio State. So Paul Brown was a well-beloved figure, and a lot of people didn't like that Art Modell fired him. I mean, come on, you're talking about Paul Brown. The team was named after him. And here's this new guy, Modell, who fires him. But he won back a lot of the love the year after Paul Brown was fired, when the Browns won the NFL championship in 1964. He puttered with the Browns for the next 30 years. Again, some people loved him, some people hated him. The Browns never went back to the Super Bowl or to the championship games. And for some people, was wearing out his welcome. He was valuable to the NFL. He helped them negotiate their big television contracts. He was one of the people behind Monday Night Football. The first Monday Night Football game, by the way, was between the Jets and the Cleveland Browns in November 1970 at Old Municipal Stadium on the banks of Lake Erie. Many of the Modell obituaries talk about his value to the NFL, and a lot of them talk about how the people in Baltimore liked him, because when he moved the Browns to Baltimore to become the Ravens, they basically took over for the Baltimore Colts, who were beloved in Baltimore, but were moved by the Ursay family to become the Indianapolis Colts. But his legacy is primarily as being an intensely disliked man in Cleveland for moving them. He's probably more disliked in Cleveland than LeBron James, and a couple of my friends in Cleveland say that Clevelanders root for two teams. They root for the new Cleveland Browns, which have nothing to do with Art Modell, and they root for any team that's playing the Baltimore Ravens. In any event, Modell and his family needed money. Some people say they were trying to avoid bankruptcy. I don't know if that's true or a cover story, but moving the Browns out of Cleveland is what he'll be known for. Bill Livingston of the Cleveland Plain Dealer, who's a very good sports writer, wrote this essay about Modell, and he tries to keep it straight and he tries to keep it honest. So this was what he wrote in the Plain Dealer after Modell died. The irony was that Art Modell at first connected so well with people in Cleveland, his adopted home. When he tore the ties out by moving the Browns, from the moment he appeared on the dais with the Baltimore officials to announce the deal until his death today, he was the biggest villain in Cleveland history. Like so much else about Modell, it didn't turn out the way he imagined it would. He fired legendary coach Paul Brown to tighten his hold on the franchise, saying he would never feel like the owner with the team's eponymous namesake around. That would be an enduring problem. Front office members would deflect credit in coming years, knowing there was only one star in that part of the organization, and it was Modell. He convinced Brown's top aide, Blanton Collier, to stay on as head coach, hoping Collier would lead an era liberated from Brown's conservatism to the heights the team deserved. But the Browns won only one NFL championship in 1964, the last league championship won by any Cleveland team using Brown's players. After Modell moved the team in 1995, he willingly surrendered the name, records, and colors. His era had never been as glorious as the one that preceded him. The championships won in the 1950s were not even recognized in the banners hanging in the Berea hallways when Modell owned the team. Modell always closely identified with the players, in part because he was a young man himself when he bought the team. He was photographed holding the ball for a field goal attempt, presumably to be kicked high and true by Lou the Toe Groza, his favorite player. Throughout his stewardship of the team, the players, almost to a man, loved him because he treated them well. Before he married, he drove around town in a Cadillac convertible with classical music playing loudly on the radio. He frequented the Pewter Mug, a bar off Public Square, at which he would sit at the fabled Table 14 with other young movers and shakers, men such as Nick Mulletti, Jim Stauffer, George Steinbrenner, and years later, when the group had migrated to Sammy's in the Flats, Dick Jacobs. They were all civic-minded men. Steinbrenner and Modell would kid each other roughly in ways that would seem inappropriate today. The ambience was part Mad Men and part Vec as in Wreck. Like Bill Vec, Steinbrenner, who nearly bought the Indians before he restored the Yankees to greatness, and Modell, who always wanted everyone to like him, would drive around downtown, bar hopping, mingling with ordinary fans, finding out what was on their minds. Modell didn't sit in the stands for a game, as did new Browns owner Jimmy Haslam III, but he tried to reach out to them. Like Vec, the populist owner of the 1948 Indians, Cleveland's last World Series champions, Modell could relate to anyone from captains of industry to the guy who several years later would don canine regalia in the dog pound. It was unimaginable then that the same Modell would cause such emotional pain, fans crowbarring their wooden seats out of old Cleveland Municipal Stadium at the last home game in 1995 before the move, grown men weeping and women wailing like an awful Greek chorus. But he did. He could not bear to part with the team by selling to local interests. Although his negotiations with television networks helped fill coffers around the NFL, Modell was never a good businessman. He hemorrhaged money after buying the old stadium, which needed immediate and costly repairs. On that last terrible day in 1995, the old stadium's advertising signs were either blacked out or removed or inverted, so toxic had become commercial association with Modell. Mayor Mike White had signs installed downtown that blinked the message, "Stop Art Modell." The owner's loge was empty, as it had been ever since the Baltimore days. On the field, Ernest Biner bowled for 131 yards and carried the Browns to their only victory in their final eight games, 26-10 over Cincinnati. Afterward, Biner took a victory lap that was really a valedictory to the fans. He jogged all the way around the field, shaking hands and receiving congratulatory hand slaps. Biner had made one of the most famous errors in football history, fumbling at the lip of the Denver goal line in the 1987 AFC Championship game, an excruciatingly close loss in the last minutes as the Browns were going into tie. The game simply became known as the fumble, the bookend to the drive the year before. The last lap was Biner's redemption, his absolution from the fans. A reporter who had been there at the fumble flashed back to the tomb-like Browns locker room in old Mile High Stadium in 1988. Biner had personally accounted for 187 yards from scrimmage in that game. After a long time, Biner emerged from the showers to face the few media members who, despite an Eastern time deadline, were still waiting for him. Modell had already shaken hands with each player, thanking them for their effort in nearly overcoming a huge early deficit. As Biner neared his locker, Modell walked toward him and said sadly, fondly, "Ernest," wrapping him in a bear hug. It was Modell's finest hour. Along with the many unpleasant things, it deserves to be remembered today. Before we close on Modell, one bit of trivia. He was married for 40 years to Patricia Breslin, who was an actress on soap operas, but she was also in one of the famous Twilight Zones of all time. Ironically, she was William Shatner's wife when he was in a coffee shop and debated whether to leave town.
Don. Don.
What?
Let's go.
No.
Are you just going to stay here?
I don't know.
Oh, sweetheart, listen to me. Please, if you love me, just listen to me.
No, you listen to me. This machine is predicting our future. Do you think I could just walk away from it?
Well, Art Modell answered that question, didn't he? We're going to move on now to the Reverend Sun Myung Moon. He died recently at the age of 92. Sometimes there's a fine line between religion and cult status, and I'm going to let Matthew Bannister of the BBC For Last Word tell his story.
The Reverend Sun Myung Moon was the self-proclaimed new messiah and founder of the Unification Church. At its height, the church claimed millions of followers and had extensive business interests around the world. The Reverend Moon cultivated leading right-wing politicians and had meetings with U.S. Presidents Nixon and Reagan and with Margaret Thatcher in Britain. But he was dogged by allegations of using brainwashing techniques, having sexual relations with his followers, and embezzlement. In the late 1980s, he served 13 months in an American federal prison for tax evasion. Mr. Moon was born Yong Myung Moon in a village in North Korea. At the age of 15, he claimed to have seen a vision of Jesus, who asked him to take over his work. Jack Corey is the UK director of the Unification Church and met Reverend Moon on many occasions.
The first impression was his smile. I felt that I've never seen a more genuine smile on anybody's face. And then the ideas that he was sharing about God and about life, it just made so much sense.
My topic tonight, as you know, is the new future of Christianity.
The Reverend Moon himself speaking through a translator. Well, Gordon Neufeld was a member of the church for 10 years, but he became disillusioned and now speaks out against it.
I cannot say that I personally was really captivated by him, but I went to many of his speeches, and his speeches usually followed a similar pattern where he would go on for quite some time, for several hours. He would ramble on about a variety of things, and some of them were a bit disjointed. But he would build up to a point where he would suddenly ask everyone to make a firm commitment. Will you do this? And we were all supposed to shout, yes.
September 18, 1974. To me and for God is a day of declaration.
I've heard it said that the Reverend Moon believed that he was the new Messiah, that he'd inherited the mantle of Jesus and that he was the new Messiah on earth. But for some Christians, that's a very blasphemous thought.
Of course. And yes, he does believe that. And he has said that, and I believe that.
Perhaps the most famous image of the Reverend Moon in action was the extraordinary mass wedding ceremonies he presided over. Both Jack Corey and Gordon Neufeld were married at one of these events.
We all went to New York City, and at the New Yorker Hotel, which Moon owns, we assembled in the grand ballroom, and the men were sitting on one side of the room and the women on the other. And Moon came into the room and gave a speech, and then he started pointing at people, and he matched us up in that manner. We were part of a column of couples, all dressed identically, the men in blue suits, the women in white bridal gowns, and we all went through the door of this arena. In the end, there were 2,075 couples. Now, we did have the opportunity to say no, but because it was sort of considered to be bad form, you know, the Messiah is telling you that this is the right person, you normally would not say no unless you had a really compelling reason to.
I proclaim that these 2,075 couples are wedded before God on July 1st, 1982.
And would you say that you were brainwashed? Because that's one of the accusations that's been made about the church.
Well, I came along with a little bit of a skeptical point of view and a concern based on my mother's dire warnings not to get involved. So I had my guard up, but my heart was open. You know, I didn't join because of Reverend Moon, put it that way.
I was still a believer, really, until 1992, 6 years after I quit, when I started reading some books about mind control, and one of them in particular, Stephen Hassan's Combating Cult Mind Control, persuaded me that, in fact, I had experienced mind control.
How do you assess the Reverend Moon's motivation? What do you think he was doing it all for?
Self-aggrandizement, I think. Just for his own glorification, because he was excited by this idea, I'm the Messiah. His plan when I first joined the church in 1976 and 77 was to convert the United States of America and to have all of the Americans become believers. He always said that 1981, there would be this big turning point, and by then a significant number of Americans would have converted. And when that didn't happen, he just started finding other ways to gain influence, and primarily by holding conferences, launching newspapers, things that would influence public opinion behind the scenes without this massive conversion that he originally wanted to have happen.
Sometimes it had interests in the media, sometimes it had interests in computer companies and so on. Why did it need to do that?
In the early days of the church, I think one of the requirements by the Korean government was that if you had a business, a certain percentage was required to support the defense industry. And based on what kind of business you had, they would allocate to you a particular product that you had to prepare. And just like the draft, you know, people don't join the army and start training to shoot rabbits. Likewise, if you know the situation of Korea, you'll realize that the whole country is on a war footing.
Well, let me just quote you something from a congressional subcommittee, which issued a report which said that the church was a multinational corporation, a paramilitary organization, and a tightly disciplined international political party, adding that among its goals is establishment of a worldwide government in which the separation of church and state would be abolished and which would be governed by Moon and his followers. Is that fair?
No, not at all.
Did the church have political ambitions?
Support individuals who are working for the betterment of the country. In fact, even Reverend Moon stated in America that he would, through his media, be ready to support people who are personally opposed to him if he felt they were good for the country, for America. For us, we're neither left nor right. I believe that our concerns are not political, primarily.
And have you ever regretted your decision to join the church?
Not for one moment.
What a fraud I was caught up in, and how infuriating that I would give so much of my life with such complete dedication to something that was so completely not what it claimed to be.
Gordon Neufeld on the Reverend Sun Myung Moon.
We're going to close tonight with Joe South, who was a session man out of Atlanta who became a great songwriter. He died recently at the age of 72, and he wrote and recorded the 1969 Grammy Song of the Year.
Well, the game be played every night and every day now. Never meaning what they say now. Never say what they mean, y'all. Wally, 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 y'all. In the average tower, duly covered up with flowers, and black limousine. Whoa, la da da da.
The song was popular because of all the S stuff that was going on in the late 60s. Actually, his most famous song wasn't mentioned in most of the obituaries. He wrote the song that we played when we did Jim Marshall, recorded by Billy Joe Royale and Deep Purple. Here is Joe South's version of Hush. Good version, even without the Marshall amps.
Hush, hush, I thought I heard her calling on me. Now hush, hush, she broke my heart, but I love her just the same. Now hush, hush.
He wrote Billy Joe Royale's two other big hits, Down in the Boondocks, which was a huge record. One I like even more, I Knew You When. I like this song, it's a good one.
I knew you when you were lonely. I knew you when you were lonely. A girl all alone without love. Yeah, 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 yeah. I knew you when.
Yeah, he meant a lot to Billy Joe Royale's career. I have to play this one. I hated it, but it was a huge country hit in 1970 by Lynn Anderson. This is the one Joe South wrote I don't like.
I beg your pardon. I never promised you a rose garden along with the sunshine. There's gotta be a little rain sometime. When you take, you gotta give, so live and let live or let go. Oh, 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 I beg your pardon. I never promised you a rose garden.
Ugh, can't close on that note. Well, I want to thank my producer, Sid Tapps, and we're going to close with a Joe South song that was a great one. Maybe as good as Hush, maybe better. I liked it and someone else liked it. It was Elvis. And Elvis used to sing this one at most of his live shows. It fit in well with his social conscious period of the late 60s. I don't think we've ever closed with an Elvis number before, but here's the King singing Joe South's great song, Walk a Mile in My Shoes.
If you could see you through my eyes instead of your ego, I believe you'd be surprised to see that you've been blind. Oh, walk a mile in my shoes. Oh,
to walk a mile in my shoes. Yeah, before you abuse, criticize, and accuse, to walk a mile in my shoes.